and welcome to this conversation with the very distinguished novelist and short story writer Yi Mun-yeol, who I was privileged enough to meet in Seoul a couple of weeks ago. And we had a fascinating conversation which raised issues of Korean culture that I hadn't understood before. And what I have, from the encounters I've had with various South Korean novelists over the last few months, what I have realized is that we have a very limited understanding of what this amazing culture is, and also how much of it is better told by the fiction writers than it can be by journalism. We often have the journalistic stories which tell one sort of story, but in order to get to the soul of a country, one wants the fiction writers, and hopefully, I very much hope that we're going to have more access to them in future. Yi Mun-yeol was born in the south in 1948, and his father, when he was very small, emigrated to the north. So he was he went in reverse, among a tide of intellectuals who traveled north when at the beginning of the Korean War. And I think that in the course of his fiction writing career, he's told this story in many different ways. At The Age of Heroes, which was published in 1984, he reconstructed what his father's life in the North might look like. And for us in the UK, it's very hard to understand what it must be like to be completely cut off from that part of your cultural identity. Then in The Poet, published in 1991, he looked at the consequences of dynastic shame, the shame visited upon the children and grandchildren of somebody who has done something awful. In this case, it was a 19th century poet who really did exist, whose grandfather was a collaborationist and therefore visited shame upon his family. In a short story, An Appointment with My Brother, he imagines a conversation that he might have with his half-brother in North Korea. So I would like to open by asking you a little bit about how you feel your life story has impacted on your fiction.
Salme, Yorogazero, Yunga, Michosmida, Asia, Chenje Guka, Dre, Hungbol Junior, Tagi, Chun Jega, Nigo, Tagi Abodina, Tosangi, Chun Chetemune, Gutashigante, Yorogazi, Gutianga, Pakia, Karan Machine, Nende, Hanguk, Hanguk, Chenje, Kunan, Pierre. 그런 그 옛날에 그 연좌제라고 하는 그 제도가 시행이 되는 바람에 그것이 아마 내 인생에 많은 변화를 줬을 것입니다.
You've just introduced me earlier, and as you said, it is true. My father fled to North Korea during the Korean War, and that has really impacted me and my fiction in numerous ways. I think this is a system found in many Asian countries with a particularly authoritarian system. But what it is there is a guilty by association law where if your father or your grandfather committed treason or any other crime against the state, you yourself is automatically guilty and charged as well. And in Korea, after the Korean War, we had, unfortunately, a similar system enforced upon us by our law, and that has negatively influenced me in some way.
그 연좌제 하에서 겪었던 어떤 그 가치 박탈이나 혹은 그 억압 같은 거 이런 것들이 아마 작가로서 내가 하고 싶은 얘기에 중요한 부분이 되었고 지금 소개하신 그 작품들을 그것들도 결국 이제 소설들로 봐서는 주제가 되는 셈인데 결국 그 주제의 중요한 부분이 그런 내가 경험했던 그 연좌제의 그늘 뭐 이런 것들이 되어서 아마 그렇게 읽히는 것 같습니다. 그러나 뭐 문제의 문학 그 전부는 아니고 아마 한 이제 3분의 1 정도 혹은 절반 정도의 중요한 주제입니다.
And because of this guilty by association law, I felt that many of my values have been stripped, and I felt this oppression laid upon me because particularly of this law. And yes, you are correct, and these elements in constituted a very important piece in all of my titles. Well, not all, but in the titles at least that you mentioned. And this has been a very important theme because it is based directly out of my own personal experience. But obviously, this is not all, the entirety of my work. I would say maybe roughly about a third to about a half of my books have this as a theme, but this definitely does not constitute all of my works.
Mm-hmm. One of you use allegory quite a lot, and in one of your most internationally successful works is Our Twisted Hero, which is about, it's a story of a boy from Seoul who goes to a provincial school and gets encounters the school monitor, who's been given power by teachers for various reasons. And it's a really complicated story of, you could see it as bullying, but of the uses, the way that power unfolds. I wonder if you could talk a little bit about that and about how it's been received.
Yeah, 그 우리들의 리베르지 영웅은 1980년대 초반에 한국 사회를 한국 사회의 한 단면을 이야기하고 있는데 그것이 이제 그 당시 사회라는 것이 직접적으로 말하기가 아주 그 여러 가지 제약이 있는 사회였습니다. 그것은 꼭 정부 당국의 검열이라든가 이런 문제도 있지만 또 반대편 소위 그들과 저항해서 싸우는 사람들한테도 역시 마찬가지로 같은 강도의 그 검열 같은 걸 느끼고 있었기 때문에 그래서 바로 그 시대의 이야기를 그리지 않고 국민학교 아이들의 교실로 바꾸어서 이야기를 했습니다.
Yes, in the case of Our Twisted Hero, this is a telling of Korean society, an allegory of Korean society, especially in the early 1980s. And at the time, in 1980s, we were in a situation in Korea where, unfortunately, we were not able to speak out forthrightly about anything that was going on in Korea. We could not directly address and criticize what is going on in Korean society, not only because there was government censorship against what we were able to say, but because there was also self-inflicted censorship, even by those who were fighting up against the government censorship. And criticizing government censorship as well. That is why I framed the story within the setting of an elementary school in a rural district, just to tell my story.
그 사실은 지금 와서 이렇게 추측해 보는 것이지만 그 내가 그 우화적인 기법을 많이 쓴 바람에 일정 부분 한국의 어떤 문화 풍토에서는 경원당하는 것도 있지 않는가 싶습니다. 왜냐하면은 내가 문화 활동을 한참 그 활발히 할 때는 소위 그 소셜 리얼리즘이라는 것이 굉장히 힘을 갖고 있어서 그들한테는 이런 알레고리적 수법이라는 것이 좀 탐탁지 않게 받아들여진 것 같습니다.
And now, when I had the chance to reflect upon what I did in the past, now that I come to think about it, I feel that Our Twisted Hero drew so much from allegory and allegoric elements that at the time it wasn't really construed seriously by the literary circles in Korea because at the time it was social realism that was the pervasive mood for the literary circles, and therefore the people who drew upon allegory to write their fiction were not really taken that seriously at the past.
Our Twisted Hero is used in American schools, isn't it? And I gather it's used as a story about bullying.
예, 그 사실은 미국뿐 아니고 한국에서도 그 국민학교 교재가 되어가지고 아이들의 왕따 문제 혹은 그 학교 폭력 문제를 다루는 것으로 이렇게 쓰이고 있습니다. 원래 내가 의도한 바는 권력, 특히 그 정당성과 정통성이 없는 권력과 그다음에 그 권력을 옹이하고 있는 지식인 그룹의 관계를 이야기해보고 싶었던 건데 그 형태가 아마 내가 국민학교 교실을 빌리는 바람에 그렇게 또 해석될 수도 있는 것 같습니다. 그래서 폭력 문제, 교실 학교 내 폭력 문제 혹은 왕따 문제 이런 걸로 자주 그 미국뿐이 아니고 또 우리나라뿐이 아니고 아마 이태리에서도 또 교재로 쓰고 있는 것 같습니다.
Yes, you're quite right. It is used as an anti-bullying sort of textbook in children, toward children in the U.S. as a way to raise awareness for them. But it's not only the U.S. because it is also used widely in Korea, in schools across Korea, especially in elementary schools, as an anti-bullying, anti-school violence textbook. And obviously, that was not my original intention going into the story. When I wrote this book, I meant it as an allegory on power, specifically the relationship between just and legitimate power as opposed to and the intellectuals who fight and sometimes try to protect that kind of power. That is, the symbolism of power was what I was going for, but because I had put this in a classroom setting, I believe that was the interpretation that some people took out of my book, and that is why it is now being used as an anti-bullying and anti-school violence school literature, not just in schools in the U.S. and in Korea, but I believe also in some schools in Italy as well.
The one thing that runs through your fiction that I'm very intrigued by, and I've seen it in the work of other writers that I've recently discovered, is what is religion and ritual? And I wonder if you could tell us what religion and ritual mean to you.
두 가지 측면으로 제가 그 종교에 대한 관심이나 혹은 그 의미 부여는 두 가지 측면으로 말할 수 있겠습니다. 하나는 우리 한국 사람들이 굉장히 종교적인 사람들입니다. 대부분의 사람들이 종교를 가지고 있고 지금 같은 경우에는 기독교 인구가 제일 많습니다. 거의 인구의 3분의 1이 넘게 절반 가까이 기독교를 믿고 있는 그런 나라이고 또 기독교가 아니더라도 무언가 믿지 않으면 안 되는 사람들이 한국 사람들인 것 같습니다. 그래서 이제 그런 종교에 관심이 많은 한국 사람에 대한 어떤 배려로서 관심이 이제 작가적인 관심이 갈 수도 있고 또 하나는 일반 그 인문학적으로 종합적인 문화 현상으로서의 종교 이것이 가지는 의미. 이제 우리가 소위 인문학이라는 것을 설명할 때 뭘 하더라도 제일 출발점이 종교가 된다는 거 이런 것들이 아마 그 인문학에서는 또 상당히 그 관심 있는 주제가 되었던 것 같습니다.
I can actually approach that question with giving two facets of my interest in religion. As you said, I am interested in religion and I try to place a certain kind of meaning in religion because, number one, many Koreans are very religious. We are a very deeply religious people and most Koreans subscribe to a particular kind of faith. And in fact, I think there are many Christians in Korea. I think about a third or even up to a half of the population are Christians. And if it's not Judeo-Christianity, they subscribe to another kind of faith. So this is the kind of people who absolutely have to believe in something. And because many of my readers, these Koreans, are interested in some kind of religion, obviously I have this authorly interest in religion as well. And secondly, I am interested in religion as a comprehensive cultural phenomenon because I feel that many of our cultural forms and media derive or originate from religion, and therefore that is why I thought that it would be an attractive theme to explore for my literature. Mm-hmm. 말씀 더 하세요.
어떨 때는 이런 현상을 예를 들면은 어떤 관념들이 원시적인 관념들이 모여서 종교적인 어떤 그 이식과 신들을 만들어내고 다시 이제 우리 어떤 문화사라는 것은 그렇게 만들어진 신으로부터 종교적인 이식을 드러내고 관념만 남기는 작업 이렇게 역순으로 가는 것 같은 느낌을 받을 때가 있습니다. 그래서 특히 문학적으로 제가 가지는 종교에 대한 관심은 그런 적도 있습니다.
Just for example, I feel that early society came up with these very basic norms that the society believes in, and these norms constituted our faith consciousness, and they came together to create these divine beings, to create these gods. And later on, in modern society, we take our gods and try to derive norms from them in return. So this opposite tendency is something that I'm very interested in from a literary standpoint.
In an appointment with my brother, your short story, the two brothers, one from the north and one from the south, have very little in common. But the thing that joins them is they make a ritual to their father on the banks of a river. And the suggestion there is that actually what both north and south still share is this, I suppose, is it a religion or is it superstition? What is it?
결국 이제 아버지란 것은 피의 동질성 같은 것을 가장 구체적으로 드러내는 존재 아니겠습니까? 그러니까 그 아버지로부터 같은 피를 받은 형제, 다른 것들은 다 살아가는 과정이 다르고 경험이 다르고 해서 달라지더라도 그래도 지울 수 없는 것, 무시할 수 없는 것, 그것이 아마 피일 것 같고 그래서 그 형제를 거의 태어나서 처음 만나는 형제들을 하나로 모으는 길은 아버지에 대해 아버지를 향해서 제사를 지내면서 피의 동정성을 서로 확인하고 또 어떤 거기서부터 이 저거의 실마리를 동질성의 실마리를 찾아가는 그런 의미를 가지고 있습니다.
Well, I feel that father represents our blood. And this is something that you cannot erase, that you cannot change. And yes, it is true in the short story that you just described, these brothers come from completely different circumstances and experiences. But what brings them together in common is the sharing of the same blood, which is represented by the father, which this blood is something that you cannot erase, that you cannot ignore. And so when these two brothers come together and meet for the first time, what happens is they don't know anything about each other, but because they come together to provide this offering in Korea, we have these memorial rites that we dedicate to our dead fathers and mothers and our ancestors, and by that they can come together and find this commonality, and that is where I tried to start my novel.
Are you read in North Korea?
아마는 읽히지 않을 것입니다. 왜냐하면 북한은 그 책을 읽는다는 것도 굉장한 통제 아래에 있어서 자기가 좋다고 이룰 수 있는 것은 아니고 아마 그 당국의 허락이 있어야 이룰 텐데 북한 당국은 아마 북한 사람들이 내 책을 읽는 걸 좋아하지 않을 거라고 추측을 합니다.
I would think that my work is not being read in North Korea. No, because North Korea is a heavily oppressed society where everything is controlled. And even if you say you want to read a book, it's not a society where you can guarantee, where you can be guaranteed that. And because you're living under incredible government's control, I would think that it would be very hard to find a copy of my book. And because you need permission from the authorities. So I wouldn't think that my book is being widely read in North Korea at all.
We've got a few minutes left, and I wondered if anyone from the floor wanted to ask any questions.
Yeah.
Have anyone? Yes, a lady at the back. We've got a roving mic, I think. Just there.
Okay. I was interested in your novel, The Poet, which is based on a real poet, as I write fictional biography. I wonder what you feel the biggest challenges are about writing about a real person when you have to invent so much of their lives. And also if you feel guilty, as I do, writing things that they've said and done and thought during the day, as you do in a novel, when inside us we know they didn't do those certain things. I wonder your ideas on that.
제 자신이 그 시인을 쓸 때는 물론 그 모델은 있었지만은 그 모델은 그 소설 창작에서의 모델이었지 내가 어떤 그 전기의 대상으로서 쓴 건 아닙니다. 그래서 처음부터 이 사람은 내가 필요한 이야기를 하기 위해서 그 사람의 어떤 부분들만 골라서 쓸 수 있고 또 어떤 부분들은 적극적으로 그게 아니라고 거짓말이라고 할 수 없는 그런 부분들 그 상상력으로 이제 채워넣고 이래서 결과적으로는 엄격한 전기로 보면은 없었던 일을 쓰거나 뭐 이렇게 되었지만은 나는 소설을 쓴 것이고 김사과 혹은 김병현이라는 사람의 전기를 쓴 게 아니고 또 내 목적은 그 사람 얘기를 한 것이 아니라 그 사람의 삶을 통해서 내 삶을 내가 경험한 어떤 그 문화적 그 이 저 성장 과정 같은 거 이런 것들을 한번 드러내보고 싶었기 때문에 조금 그 전기 자체를 하고 쓰는 거하고 조금 다른 게 있을 것 같습니다.
Yes, my approach was as a fictional biography and not as not a literal biography, which made it very different. And when I was writing the poet, it is true that I drove my inspiration from a figure who actually lived in history, and he was my model for the fictional biography. But this was, in essence, a fictional biography and not an actual biography. So what I did was I chose elements from his life that I wanted to write about and use my imagination to fill up the rest and to try to fill up things that I wanted to write about. But if I were to write them, they would have been construed as lies. So I drew upon my imagination for that. And yes, this is a person who lived in real life. His name was Kim Sat-kat, but my goal was different. It wasn't to try to portray his life. It was to try to use his life to tell the story of my life. So I think because of that different viewpoint and different goal that I had in mind, I had a different approach, obviously. And what I wanted to do was give a telling of my literary coming of age through this man.
그래서 그게 어떤 이야기들은 만들어진 것처럼 보일지도 하지만 그래도 완전히 가공으로 만들어낸 것은 없고 충분히 그럴 만하다라는 것만 만들었습니다. 이를테면 어떤 것들은 이제 이런 전기적인 전기를 보는 눈으로 볼 때는 만든 얘기처럼 보이지만 그건 그 나름대로 또 그 사람 삶을 추적을 하면은 충분히 그런 의심을 가질 수 있는 자료들이 있는 것만 그렇게 픽션화했습니다.
But I was very careful to make it a point that when I did use my imagination to write instances that certainly didn't happen in history, you can read some of the elements in this book and feel that many of the scenes have been completely manufactured, but I took very much care to try to make it seem believable, that I did not just come up with this out of thin air, that this is quite possible and this would have actually happened if you actually read about his life and you draw upon historical research and data, that this might be something that could have happened. So I try to take care of doing that.
한 가지 예를 들면은 한국에서 그냥 떠돌아다니는 김사깟 이야기에는 김사깟이라는 사람은 자기 할아버지가 반역자를 도와서 반역자한테 항복을 해서 이제 그 벼슬을 받은 일 그게 알려지면서 그 세상에서는 출세를 포기하고 처음부터 출세를 포기하고 떠돈 사람으로 되어 있습니다. 그러나 내 작품에서는 굉장히 어디 군문세가에 아주 그 세력 있는 집에 빌붙어서 또 세속적인 출세를 해보려고 노력하다가 결국 떨려나는 것으로 되어 있습니다. 그래서 일반적인 그 너무 길나요?
Am I too? I 계속하셔도 예, is he's, 예, he has time,
예,
right?
예, yeah. 예, 일반적인 그 저 설화에서는 설화 얘기를 익숙한 사람들은 이거 아닌데라고 하지만 어떤 기록에는 이 사람이 실제로 그 당시에 가장 세력이 좋던 안동 김씨 가문에 가서 어떻게 세속적으로 출세를 해보려고 노력했던 것이 나옵니다. 그리고 내가 보기에는 그게 더 훨씬 인간적이라고 보이고요. 이런 경우인데 이런 경우는 물론 일반적인 설화하고는 다르지만 그러나 내가 완전히 흙으로 지어낸 것은 아니다라는 뜻입니다.
Just to give you an example, this Kim Sat-kat was the wandering poet in Korea and the historical figure that I drew my inspiration from. But in fact, he had a grandfather who aided and abetted a treasonous man. And because of the guilty by association law that I told you about earlier, he was fated to never achieve worldly success. So what he did was he just gave up that idea entirely because he could not work in government or do anything, so he just gave up that idea and went and to live on as a wandering poet. But in my novel, what I did was I painted a slightly different picture of the poet so that I drew him as a man who still wanted to achieve worldly success somehow. So he goes to live with a rich and affluent family, and he tries to use them to gain worldly success, which goes fruitless in the end, and he couldn't achieve worldly success in the end, but I still try to give a different picture of him. Now, the people who are very faithful toward Korean history and oral tales would say that I shouldn't have done that because this is completely different. But if you actually look at historical data and records, there are some elements that you can point to make it seem that, yes, this might have happened, that this is a man who might not have completely ignored his ambition. And because in actual fact, there are instances where they say that Kim Sat-gat, he tried to maintain friendly relations with the Kim family, which was the most influential family during his time. So I try to draw upon that as well. In that way, I wanted to try to humanize him in a way.
Thank you. Do we have any more? No. I've got one last question if there's nobody else. No? Yeah, one last question, which is about the popularity of short stories and novellas in Korea. Why are there so many?
한국 현대 소설은 우리가 서양에서 도입한 지가 한 100년 됩니다. 100년 되는데 아마 그 도입 과정에서 좀 이렇게 규모가 적고 습득하기가 쉬웠던 것이 장편보다는 단편이 아니었던가 싶습니다. 그래서 거의 그 1990년대까지도 한국 문단은 어떤 의미에서는 단편 위주로 그 운영되는 문단이었습니다. 모든 작가들이 등단하는 길은 단편을 써서 단편을 통해서만 등단하게 되고 장편으로 등단하는 길은 아주 드물었습니다. 드물었는데 요즘은 이제 꼭 그렇지도 않습니다. 지금 이제 어떤 사람은 전혀 단편도 쓰지 않고 장편만 쓰는 사람도 있고 또 어떤 사람들은 뭐 섞어서 쓰고 하는데 그 아마 그 발전 단계에서 특별한 현상 같습니다.
I think to answer that question, I would have to look back towards the introduction of novellas into our country. I think the formats of contemporary novels, as we know them in Korea, were first introduced to our country about 100 years ago. We brought them in from the West. And at the time when we brought them in from the West, it was easier for us to adapt to shorter works. So obviously short fiction, and they were just easier for us to approach, should I say. And until 1990s, in fact, most Koreans would widely read short stories and novellas as opposed to longer works of feature fiction. And in fact, for a very long time, for many years, in fact, most writers would make their literary debut with short stories and not so much works of long fiction. It was very rare. But now times have changed, and now, in fact, there are some writers who I believe don't write short stories at all, and they just write long pieces of fiction. And some writers do a mix of both, but I think many things have changed. But I do believe that the pervasive influence of short stories is attributed to our history of how we receive them and in how they were how they came to our shores in the early stages, like 100 years ago.
제 자신을 예로 들면은 저도 작가가 되기 위해서 준비할 때는 단편을 많이 쓰고 또 초기 등단 초기 한 10년 동안에 내 단편 50편을 다 썼습니다. 그리고 20년째 단 한 편도 단편을 안 쓰고 장편만 쓰고 있습니다.
For example, if I were to give you my own experience, when I was preparing to be a writer and I was preparing for my debut, I think for about those 10 years after my debut, I wrote all of the 50 short stories that I currently possess. And as I was preparing for my debut, I obviously worked on writing a lot of short stories. But after those initial 10 years, for the next 20 years, I haven't written a single piece of short story.
Well, I think that's all we've got time for. Thank you very much. And Munyol will be translated as part of Dolki Archives' 25 Korean classics in translation, which it's doing in partnership with the Literature Translation Institute Korea, which is a fantastic initiative, and I hope that I will certainly be reading a lot more of these classics that I have not been able to read up till now. Thank you very much for coming, and thank you.
아이고.